Some of the solutions suggested in that panel were clearly about establishing, an incubator or an accelerator program. In some cases, people spoke about how, they're looking at driving mergers and acquisitions with some of these upcoming enterprises and then bringing that innovation within the organization. We're going to focus on the former, where we are looking at the accelerator and incubator program. And we have a galaxy of accelerator heads here, so a lot of the questions that I will be asking to the panel will be focused on that. But before we get started, I just want to get a sense of the people in this room. Can I have a show of hands of people who are representing the startup community? Are there any startups here? So guys, if you're pitching, this is the group that you need to be going after. I also want to just get a sense of people who are driving any accelerator programs at the moment. Is there anybody who's currently running an accelerator? One lady there. Are there others who are looking at learning from this panel about how to run an accelerator? Is your organization currently exploring an accelerator setup? Okay. So I think a lot of the questions we'll try to focus it around this set, right? So before we get started, I think the others are looking for some fun and some insights. Okay. So we'll just start this panel with a quick round of introduction. So if I could ask each one of you to talk a little about the program that you're running and what is in it for the startups to work with. Ajeya, will start with you.
Sure. We have the NetApp Accelerator, the startup accelerator for NetApp. I kind of alluded to it a few minutes ago when I spoke. The entire value prop of the accelerator is we have no, we don't have a stake, we don't have any equity in any of the startups that we're going to accelerate. This is primarily to foster innovation in the environment that we're in. It's going to be centered around data. We're going to help startups through mentorships, through equity-free grants, and go-to-market abilities. This is basically to improve the innovation around data and the data ecosystem to build excellent products in India for the world.
I used to go Launchpad. This is about a year program. We've been in existence for about a year. We're in our second cohort right now. I'd just say for us, this is really about that vision of digitally enabling the next 3 billion internet users. And we think it takes an ecosystem approach to be able to do that, an ecosystem of companies like Cisco, the innovation that startups bring, as well as our large partner community, to create those digital solutions that enable business outcomes. So we focus largely, being a B2B company, focus on B2B startups that have deep tech and preferably some intellectual property. And we want to bring to bear the power of Cisco's go-to-market and technology expertise to help them both succeed in their own right and also alongside Cisco. So that's what we focus on.
Hi everyone. I run, or actually I founded, an accelerator called Brigade. REAP will stands for Real Estate Accelerator Program. It's the country's first and only real estate focused accelerator program. And what it does is we take in startups whose end product or service can be applied in the real estate space. The idea is to, Brigade Group being a real estate developer, that's our domain knowledge, that's what we know best. So what we do is we work with the startups to help them tweak their business model to make it applicable to the real estate community. And then we take these startups to our other real estate developers and the industry at large. We give them proof of concept at Brigade. And then of course we help tweak their business model to ensure that they have good GTM strategy and also help them fundraise at the end of each batch. So that's our focus. And it's primarily not in e-commerce space, so we try to do again a lot of B2B type of startups, but that's not to say we don't do B2C as well. It's just that we want technology disruptors and not just e-commerce players. Thanks.
So I'm Srinivas. I'm the founder and chief operating officer of T-Hub. We're based in Hyderabad. Our mandate is to make Hyderabad a startup destination. But broader than that, it's about finding great companies from all over, helping them to scale. We do that in multiple ways. We run India's largest incubator, and we're in the process of building the world's largest. We run multiple corporate innovation programs with partners. And we help several of those companies get funded. So in a nutshell, that's what we do.
Srini, could you talk a little about, you said, you're in the process of setting up the world's largest accelerator. Could you talk a little about that?
Sure. It's not an accelerator. It's a building for entrepreneurs. And I say that specifically because within the building will be multiple accelerators, multiple incubators, corporate innovation labs, and lots of startups. So it's an entire ecosystem within one building. It's a 360,000 square feet of space. So the idea is, again, it's the ecosystem approach. You need all of the different stakeholders to be represented and working together so that everybody wins. So that's the idea.
When we did the show of hands, one of the things that I noticed was a lot of you in this room are interested to know how do you go about setting up an accelerator program. So I'm going to actually pick Sriram's brains here. They have already finished one cohort and are in the process of running a second one. So Sriram, could you share your thoughts in terms of what do you think are the critical elements when you're looking to evaluate an accelerator and how do you go about setting up one?
Yeah, absolutely. I think you start with your kind of 30,000 foot level. You really have to have a clear idea as to how such a program fits into your overall innovation thesis and agenda. And if you look at innovation as a multi-lever or a multi-pronged approach, there's a place for things like M&A and strategic partnerships and et cetera. And you need to rationalize a program such as this as to how it's going to complement and synergize those effects. And you need strong partnerships from your organizations like Portdev, your partner organization, the sales organization. So from a process perspective, this alignment is what we first and foremost focus on at a global, truly global level, right? And so that we have that executive leverage and governance to keep something like this growing and over time. So the second thing that we really look at is how do we bring our technology and business expertise into a program like this, and we actually went for a much more of a high touch and and deep engagement model as opposed to trying to do this at a scale of a 50 or 100 or more. And sometimes people come and ask, you are such a large company, you take 8 startups in a cohort. Why? Because for us, fewer and better has been the mantra. And really being able to focus and alter the trajectories of these companies alongside Cisco has been one of our companies. And there is obviously working with ecosystem partners who know how to set up accelerators. We benefited a lot from the ops expertise in that case, and operationalizing it with a very much of a startup mentality, right? Because I always used to joke even with you, Preeti, that we're incubating an accelerator. So there is going to be learnings along the way. You try and you adapt, and in the process, you get better, and so that's how we approached it when we set it up. So,
Nirupa, I want to pick your brains on the same question because Brigade's accelerator is quite focused on a particular domain, whereas NetApp and Cisco, being the technology companies they are, and it's almost all pervasive, right? They're looking at IoT, machine learning. I think a lot of that comes into your accelerator as well, but you have defined a boundary within which you operate. So how do you go about thinking through a program which is verticalized or industry specific?
Basically what happened is, as you know, not many developers are into fostering this whole ecosystem, right, as you say. But what happened is, every week we have 2-3 companies reaching out to us saying, hey, we want to come pitch to your company. So we'd say, okay, looks like a nice idea, let's meet them. And then we would meet them and say, hey, great idea, but you need to tweak this, this, and this for us to be able to use it. Because you're talking about a 30-year-old company using, say, a software or product of, say, a newly formed company, and there are so many questions, and it's not completely tailor-made to you. So we would always say, hey, you need to make these tweaks, and then we would either not follow up from our side because there's no focus team to sort of work with those startups, or the startups would not be able to make those changes without more guidance from us, and then the discussion would fall flat. So that's when the whole concept of, hey, let's create a team to focus on this whole startup world, because there are a lot of great ideas out there. They just need a bit of guidance and mentoring to help them cater their business or their product or service to the real estate space. But nobody, everybody's busy in their day-to-day life and work and everything. So we decided to create a specific team to sort of focus on this, on just the startups who could cater to the real estate space. And the reason we did that was because I needed to rationalize it to the board of the company. I couldn't just say, hey, we are accelerating this company in pharma or animation or something like that. No, I had to show how it would add value to our existing business. Either it has to increase revenue or cut costs or save time or enhance customer experience. So as long as it does any of those four to our business, then I could rationalize it. So that's how the whole process went about, and then we approached the board and to give a feasibility. So we do take some equity upfront because I believe that, you know, there's a lot of time and effort and management skill that goes into working with these startups. And when you take a small bit of equity, they actually want to squeeze more out of you, which is good for us. You know, they demand more because they're giving you equity. They're not going to give it for free without getting anything back in return. So we, our philosophy is that let's charge a very small percentage of equity. So let the startup also be responsible for extracting the max out of us. So that's how the whole concept started, and that's how we said, okay, let's create a domain-focused accelerator.
So Nirupa, what attracts these startups to your program? Because many of the startups that work with you are in the technology space, but Brigade is not seen as a tech player, at least not yet. So why do these startups come to you?
Because they have a product or service for the real estate space. They probably, we work with slightly more later stage startups. So they're probably companies who have an idea, who have some proof of concept, they have some customers. They've grown from point A to point B. But in order to exponentially scale up their business, they need some help. You know, they're probably not making enough traction because their model is probably requires tweaking. Maybe the pricing model requires tweaking. Maybe the way they're approaching the problem. You know, somebody in the previous panel said, are they framing the question properly? Are they framing the problem properly? So that's why they come to us, because we provide them the domain expertise. Not all of them, all the founders of real estate startups are not, they don't necessarily come from the background of the real estate space. So they need somebody to give them that domain expertise to say how they work, get into the minds of how real estate developers think. And once they click with us, it's very easy to say, hey, we're working with Brigade, then it's easy to go to 10 other developers or 20 other developers. And as part of our accelerator, we take them to CRIDAI, which is the real estate body of, you know, developers. So we give them access to 1,000 other developers. So if they click with us, they know that their ability to gain additional customers is that much more and easier.
So in essence, you become a customer to the startup.
Yeah.
Because you try and test out the
product. Yeah, absolutely.
So, Ajeya, my next question is to you, because being a technology company and NetApp being the size that it is, when you start working with a startup, you're not going to be automatically their first customer. Your value proposition with the startup is going to be very different. So how do you distinguish yourself there? And especially because you're the newest kid on the block.
Yep.
And there are many more accelerators there. How do you uniquely differentiate yourself?
So NetApp was a startup launch, right? I mean, and we consider ourselves like a huge startup even now, right? So our philosophy has been that we've always played with bigger players. We've always competed against companies that were 10x bigger than us. And then we have won in many cases. And the way we have done that is through innovation. NetApp has out-innovated its competitors that were much bigger than itself to actually win in the market. We would like to create a collaboration of such ecosystem players in the data space that can actually do something similar, right? So they could be consumers of our platform. Eventually, we have a data fabric that helps people within the hybrid cloud. They could be consumers of the hybrid cloud, or they could be an endpoint of the hybrid cloud itself, or they could do something entirely different, which would complement the solution that we are taking to the market when we actually go to the market together. Whatever it is, we would not really like to take any equity, because we understand startups very well. We don't want to touch their equity because they want to be independent. They want to have control of their destiny. And if we find a shared destiny in their destiny, then we'll actually go with them, or we'll let them be. I think that's what we want to do. And being the newest kid on the block, I think we want to offer a value prop that's unique and unshackled in a way for the startups, so that they find it comfortable to pursue what they want to pursue.
Okay. So, Zinnov, having run multiple accelerator programs and we're out there in the startup ecosystem, one of the two things that we see startups generally vying for, one is capital, and the other is largely access to customer base. So Srini, in that aspect, I wanted to understand, because your focus from an accelerator point is I wouldn't say philanthropic, but it is not driven by strong business outcomes. So how do you, what makes an accelerator or incubator program that PR drives, what makes it attractive for startups to work with you?
So first of all, we definitely are focused on business outcomes. But it's not for the team, it's for the partner. So we run accelerator programs or innovation programs for guys like Cisco, guys like Intel, Qualcomm, Samsung, United Technologies. These guys, yes, multiples. They all have very, very clear outcomes that they're focused on. And part of our job, as we work with multiple, is to figure out what is it that corporate is looking at. Different companies have different outcomes that they're looking at. A lot of it is driven by which department is actually funding. And if it's coming out of R&D, it's a set of outcomes. It'll all depend on that. So first of all, go in and understand what it is that they're looking for. Map out what stage of startups they're looking at, what domain they're looking at, are there specific challenges that they're looking at, and focus it around that. And then the program entirely becomes focused on finding the right companies and helping them to scale. In some cases, also matching it to the internal architecture of the company as well, of the partner company also. But yeah, it all depends on the partner that we're working with.
Before we take questions from the audience, I have one question. We frequently see that there's a dilemma that exists in the startup ecosystem, right? The early stage startups are the ones who require the most amount of help, but they are not yet ready to create enterprise-grade products from the start, right? They are still in their journey. Whereas with the more, slightly more mature startups, they may feel that they are beyond the acceleration stage. So what kind of challenges or opportunities do you see in the ecosystem when you look at the startup community as a whole? So I will take that question first to you, Nirupa, and see what your thoughts are.
Challenges in terms of?
In terms of the startup ecosystem, do you see it's mature enough to work with? Do you see it's still, there are lots of early stage startups who have a good idea, but they have not yet reached a product stage?
Yeah, so that's happened with us. We try to say we go with later stage startups, but like you said, some of the really well established ones do think they're beyond acceleration, and they might be a little more hesitant because of whatever their valuation and all that is to sort of part with some equity and things like that. I think there's a fine balance between that early stage. Again, the definitions we all know are very blurry. So between that early stage and late stage or advanced stage, there is one stage of startups where they have some customers, they have an idea, they have some paying customers, but something is holding them back from scaling up exponentially. So that's the area we try to come in, because we don't have that balance. When you have an accelerator program, it's not an incubation. We don't have 1 year to work with the startups, we have 4 months. So in those 4 months, for the startup to get the maximum out of us, they need to know what they do, like where they are, where they want to go, and whatever their vision for the company is. If we take in very early stage startups with just an idea, or just toying with one or two customers, then they're not going to be able to get the maximum out of the acceleration program, and then they're going to not like the fact that they gave up 1 or 2% of equity to us. So we have to also take startups at the right stage. We have dealt with a couple of early companies where they didn't know where they wanted to be, and then either they dropped out or we said, this is, you need to figure out what you want to do before we are able to help you out. So they did drop out. Couple of later stage ones, they said, okay, we just need money, we need to raise funds. So we said, we are not the players for you. If you just want to raise funds to other developers and want us to be in the first year, that's not going to happen. That's not our value proposition in any case. So that didn't happen. But, there are still some that you can help. I think probably the first batch had 5 companies. One dropped out because of this issue. It was too early. They didn't know where they wanted to be. Out of the 10 that we have now, or 9 that we have now, again, one might drop out. Because again, they need to figure out what they want to do. Until and unless they are clear about what they want to do, it's very hard to sort of help them out.
What Nirupa said, I think for us, it's really about a portfolio approach. We really look at it as a portfolio of ideas and stages out there. And you have to have a strong thesis. The 3 things that we really look for: you have an awesome idea,
a great team that can execute well, and is there potential, I stress potential, for synergies and collaboration with Cisco down the line. So that's the lens we put on the selection. And so as a result of which, you know, we've taken some really early stage startups because they're working on some really cool tech that we think is going to create a huge amount of value. And want to be able to, A, you know, set them down the right track as well as, you know, influence their evolution of their technology and their business models. And when it, if and when it makes sense to discuss further down the line, maybe it could be a year or 3 years down the line, we're happy to have that conversation. Same thing with a company that is working on very relevant problems for communication technologies in India, right? And their incubator of IASC, we love them, we took them, and then we'll probably continue to engage with them and create more of a long-term roadmap for how we want to collaborate. On the other hand, somebody that is really ready for prime time, we say, yes, you're beyond acceleration, let's talk GTM. You guys have a product that you're ready to, let's see if we can go to market together and see if we can create more of a business partnership. So that's the, and there are obviously that sweet spot where people have, startups have MVP and they're ready for at that inflection point of scale and growth. And that's where we take them through the traditional acceleration.
So basically what I heard Nirupa say, that there is a sweet spot that you can identify, and what I heard you say is that the program should also be flexible to engage with multiple stages of startups, right? So at that point, I want to see if there's any questions from the audience. Is the gentleman here?
Yeah.
Could you please introduce yourself?
Hi, my name is Uday, and I come from Lollipop. So we're a design-based, studio-based company. And of late, we've had experiences working with VCs and accelerator programs working online. But what we realized that some of the clients they come to us through VCs, we found that there's confusion in building a product, giving it a shape. In terms of features, MVPs, so on and so forth. So some of them get dropped out in between. And how does the VCs consider at what stage that the companies should go for a design firm for defining the product or designing the product? Number one. Number two, what I feel is how does in the ecosystem of VCs and clients, design firm contribute or have its partnership in itself. These are the two questions that I have.
Are you referring to user experience design or
user experience?
Okay.
Is there a specific panel number that you want to address?
So, but first of all, you're asking about venture capital advice, and none of us are venture capitalists. Having said that, user experience is something that's it's a very interesting topic, right? I mean, in India, I think it's misunderstood a lot by a lot of the early stage startups. They think it means pretty pictures and the right colors on your website. Clearly, it's not that. I mean, it's everything from design thinking, figuring out in the beginning what problem you're solving for which set of customers, and how you design the product being experienced for that set of customers. I think. Ideally speaking, it should be right from the beginning. In India, that doesn't happen like you said, and you know, you've had experience in that already. Ideally, it should be there. It's very hard once you build the product to retrofit it, right?
Yeah.
So, I mean, I would say it has to be from the beginning, but I don't know what advice to give you other than try and engage with smart startups and get it from the beginning.
So I think, to build on your answer, we do a lot of user experience design at NetApp, right? And while kind of designing our cohort, we've actually had that as one of the main curriculum items where we actually compulsorily take startups through something like user experience design to start with. And we consider that as equally important as a product or market fit, so you're successful once you go out. So in all of our products, I think that's like the most important thing to do. So irrespective of VC, I don't know how you got a VC angle to that question, but irrespective of the VC, a product needs a great user experience design, whichever market segment that you're targeting them. That's what I'm saying.
Okay.
Hi. I just have one question, and this is regarding the product itself. A product which a startup develops. So, the question is, nearly every segment today is already disrupted, and there is a leader, say, we Cisco for network and cloud or NetApp. So, what if there is a startup which is disrupting in that space and you know, trying to build or trying to better a BT, and how would an accelerator look at such a startup? So, would you encourage it? I mean, I just want to know your view on such a startup which tries to equal an Excel biggie in the same space. So that's my question.
So, I mean, I'll ask you to answer that, because you know the process of selecting your first cohort.
So let me understand the question. So you're saying that how would you look at a startup that's going to do something similar to somebody who's already disrupted in the same space?
Exactly. And something I would say which you just said in the beginning of your talk, that NetApp, even beat its 10x big companies which were in the same space.
Yeah, so the nuanced difference in what I said was that we will definitely look at startups that are trying to challenge the big guys in the same space, not necessarily doing the same things. Right. So as long as you have a differentiated solution or you have a differentiated approach to what product that you're actually building, you would definitely go ahead and encourage it. Right. If you're doing things better, if you're doing things differently, and you should definitely have the right to expect different results, and we are there to support that.
Things differently and better, that's a very generic thing. What exactly do you expect? What is the exact thing that has to be different and better?
So we would definitely look at what kind of prototype you have and what is your approach to solving a problem. So there are several big problems to solve, right? So suppose you're dealing with big data or analytics. Suppose you're trying to deal with unstructured data. Maybe you're using some database, like, I don't know, MongoDB, Cassandra, I don't know what you want to use. So we want to basically look at what kind of approach you're taking. Are you doing in-memory analytics? Are you trying to use some traditional approaches? Are you doing SQL injection? So it all depends on various types of technologies you're trying to use to solve a problem. There's a lot of problems, big problems, a lot of companies are there, especially in big data space. For example, I just took that as one of the examples. I would have talked easily about hybrid cloud as well. But we would be looking at the quality of your solution and the efficiency of the results that it's going to deliver, right? So you can have an offline chat in specifics, but you'll definitely look at the caliber of the product that you're actually putting on it.
I think the other thing I just want to mention is that even to get into an accelerator, you have to drop to a certain stage. An accelerator, by definition, is a short-term structured program, right? It doesn't work well with guys that are very, very early, that just have an idea. You have to have some kind of traction, hopefully, to get there. So, I mean, most people, when they're looking at a new batch, you're looking at all the things that he said, plus, are they at the stage where they can accept the guidance that come in the interventions of the programs?
That's fantastic, right? So, we would like to accelerate startups to whom we would feel that we can add value to them. If we feel that we cannot add that value, we would say, you know, maybe you have a better plan somewhere else. So, actually, thanks for...
Yeah, just to add to that, you know, we are working with one software company that was trying to take on AutoCAD. AutoCAD is used by almost every architect in the world or in the country. So they were trying to take on AutoCAD, and similar to what Ajay was saying, you know, we try to see if you're providing the same value or the same cost and everything, then obviously it's not very exciting. But maybe if you're providing the same service at 1/100 the cost or 1/10 the cost, but also adding maybe that user interface is better, or maybe just the user experience is better, and also what additional value proposition is that smaller company being able to give. So we actually took them to a bunch of architects. We took them to about maybe a dozen architects in Bangalore, and then actually worked with the architects to understand what do they like and what do they not like about AutoCAD, for instance. And, you know, trying to see whether this company could kind of work on the things where people thought AutoCAD could be better, just as an example. So those are the things you can look at.
I hope that answers your question. Customers are the best judge of the people of product. We've completely run out of time, but I want to make sure that we get one question answered, and this will again be across the panel, because many of you have been running this program for a while, and I know NetApp has just started, but you've also gone through some phases of thinking. What are some of your key learnings which you have experienced during running these programs, and which you can offer as practical advice to anybody out here in the audience who are potentially evaluating, or they are already in that journey, but there's something that you can share from your own experiences which can be an advice to them in terms of avoiding some common pitfalls?
Is this for the startups or for the corporates looking at acceleration?
For the corporates.
For the corporates looking at acceleration. So, one is just figure out what exactly the outcomes you're looking for are. Be really, really specific about them. The more vague it is, the more likely your program won't work. So figure out what are the outcomes, what are the resources that would be required internally. Because one of the things I've noticed is a lot of times they think it's really easy and they just can hire a partner and don't have to. It always requires effort from the corporate itself. Multiple departments within the corporate have to get involved in mentorship, etc. And then the other one is think about whether you want to do it internally or with a partner as well. Is another important one. I mean, obviously, we work with partners ourselves. There's advantages and disadvantages to both sides. I'm not saying one is better. But these are the basic things you should think through as well.
I think one thing that kind of took me by surprise was the fact that, you know, you think you're going to be mentoring a company on their business model and this and that, but then you land up realizing there are so many other issues that you'll end up mentoring them on. It's the legal issues, it's the founder issues, it's the investor issues. So you do take on a lot more than you signed up for. So you definitely need a focused team to sort of help you with that. So Brigade is doing it in-house. We did evaluate initially whether to do it externally or in-house, but then later, anyway, it was a matter of finding the right team to help us with that. And once we found the right team, it was a lot more easier to do in-house. But then the team does take on a lot of these other issues. It's not a very blinker-focused acceleration program. You'll end up helping them with everything, right? Any legal issues, personal issues, father-son issues, whatever it may be. So that's what I would
say. Yeah. I'll just re-emphasize very quickly what both of them touched upon. You have to do the heavy lifting as the owner of the accelerator. The buck stops at your table. You may have a partner that is going along with you on the journey, but make no mistake about it, it is going to take a lot of work to rally the organization, say that at the scale of Cisco, to make the program and the startup successful, I would say that. Then the second thing is fit is extremely important as you go through the selection process. That somebody may look great on paper, impeccable credentials, but it's really about the coachability, right? Whether they hang together as a team, are they willing to invest the time and bear the so-called opportunity cost to be part of your program versus taking a customer meeting. And the third thing is whether they are invested in this journey with you long term. If they're just looking at it as I'm going to get in and out and maybe make some a few $1,000s of money, grant money, and that's not going to be. So in that sense, you have to be very careful about the right fit as you put together your proposal.
Yeah, I think I couldn't agree more with any of what everybody else has said here, but one advice I got when we actually started on this is that the startup has actually come to your accelerator on independent companies, and you're actually accelerating them for the strengths that they have, and they're not going to be working for you. So that's something that we need to remember, and that they're independent, they're there to be successful, and they have the individuality and the independence to work on their own. So you're going to be helping them, and don't be able to use that. They're kind of working for you, or you have any control over them. So that's something that you've got to be clear when you start something like this.
I'll just make one last point. I think initially, at least, you have to give more than you will get. This is going to take time to pay off. So stakeholder management, internal stakeholder management is key. So if somebody's looking for ROI at the end of the year, get past that question first, and really look at it as a long-term strategic bet that you're facing.
That's some great advice, and if I quickly summarize, what I heard was be focused, find the right fit, be flexible, because you're going to sign up for a lot more than what you initially thought. And I think Ajeya, we pretty much heard a lot of that coming back, but also being very flexible with the startup, giving them the freedom to work. So So with that, we come to the close of the panel. I'm very grateful to you for being a patient audience, and I would like to thank each one of our panel members for being here. Thank you so much.
Thank you.